Oh no!
Yeah, I mean, I think the whole situation is just not acceptable. That Meta need to really start looking at the problems of online fraud that are sort of filtrating through their networks. I've listened to the two previous stories you've done through you and yours, and the sort of huge impact that's had on the victims. And what's interesting is also people assume that people who are victims of fraud are older, and actually what we've seen across the broadcasts that you've been doing, that actually this is a young person's crime as much as an older person's crime, and it's about time the platform stepped up to realise that they need to take some responsibility and help victims of crime that are being infiltrated through their platforms.
I'll just tell you what Meta told us. They said, we don't want fraudulent activity on Instagram. We have restored access to the accounts brought to our attention by the BBC, that's us, and we continue to invest in people and technology to help detect this type of activity and to remove the people responsible. And they say that as a company, they have donated £3 million to Citizens Advice to deliver a UK scam action programme. What do you say to that?
Any intervention, if they're giving that funding, is welcome, of course. However, we're in a position where they can create an algorithm to target you for something that they wish to advertise or that pays advertising. But then when you say to them, can you please tackle the issues of fraud, like Miss Cherry has faced, taking 35 attempts to try and change her password. Now, the BBC get in touch, and I'm delighted that they respond to media requests not to have that bad publicity to then take down some of those fake accounts. But we shouldn't be in this position. Customers of Instagram, of Meta, should be able to contact through one straightforward service saying, I think I'm a victim of fraud, can you help? And shouldn't be having to spend hours and hours and hours tackling this problem. And the reality is we've had many, many years now of self-governance and self-regulation of platforms. And the huge increase in online fraud in recent years just shows that actually there needs to be more serious intervention from government, but also more responsibility from the platforms.
There are new laws, aren't there, going through Parliament to try and make the online world more secure. The Online Safety Bill includes fraud and will make service providers like Meta responsible for what's happening on their platforms. Will that sort it?
I mean, I think it will to a point. I would make the point the bill's been 3 years in the making. We've had to drag the government kicking and screaming to ensure that fraud is now on the face of the bill. Just a few months back, they said they couldn't do it, and I think that's very disappointing. But equally, the bill only covers user-generated fraud. So if you were to look at scams via advertising, email, clone websites, this all falls outside of the bill. So really, it's giving a bit of a get-out-of-jail-free card for anyone who's paying small amounts of money to promote content.
Sorry, but where Meta is concerned, if they are made responsible, as the bill now includes this proposal, if they are made responsible for fraud on their site, will that sort it?
Well, no, they were there right until that contract happened, and then
you were
with it.
That was
where are we going back?
The champion.
give me no idea how long it would be. And I just feel someone must know, you know, per area or per county, how many people are waiting, how many operations they can do per day or per week. I should be able to know where I am, because I can't arrange holidays, I can't arrange to work. I've been offered work in the summer teaching stone carving. I don't know if I'll be able to do that. I don't know if I'll be well enough. I don't know if I'll be asked to go for an appointment. I can't book a holiday.
Yes, it's horrible. I wonder, Bob, is there anything you'd like to say to Sarah? Anything you'd like to say to each other, since you're both living with this pain and uncertainty?
Well, other than agreeing with Sarah on the constant nature of the pain, which is worse at some times than others, it's the not knowing how long it's going to be. So my foot thing has been in abeyance for well over 2 years now, and my hip, I think, it's been several months since I first sought help. And although I was in the
face-to-face on a video call, and then just saying, you've got it, I'm prescribing this. And I've been taking it now for about 4 weeks, and the change is immense. It's immense. And it's just a simple, drug. You know, with not many side effects, I don't think. Blood pressure is one of them, but that's, you know, they're monitoring that. I feel incredibly desperate.
David, I'm glad to hear that. Thank you for getting in touch. We've just been emailed by someone who wants to be anonymous, saying that their 12-year-old is waiting for an autism diagnosis and is struggling with depression, anxiety, unable to attend school full-time. This listener says, we are taking time off work every day to transport our child to school. We have been told the waiting list is 3 years. The impact on our whole family is enormous. And Professor John Appleby's with us today. He's Director of Research and Chief Economist of the Nuffield Trust, an independent health think tank. Professor Appleby, mental health services, there's also a huge unmet need there, as we're hearing.
Yes, absolutely. And I'll be guilty when we're talking earlier on, where we're just referring to other hospital services, but we mustn't forget community services and mental health services. And one thing that does strike me is that quite a lot of your callers, some of the issues are not just COVID specific, if you see what I mean, in terms of the backlog. They go back some time. People have been in pain on lists and so on. And we know that mental health has been a problem. I should say I'm a member of an expert group working for the Health Select Committee in Parliament, and our job is to rate government targets in various areas.
Victoria and Northern Moor because of those same problems and more traffic and travel problems. us just before the golden hour, straight after the news at 12 noon here on BBC Radio Manchester.
Phil Shrow. Coming up this week, 20 years after he won Pop Idol, we speak to William.
I had a job at Sony Music Publishing, so I probably would have gone into that and then probably ended up doing something with animal charities.
Telling us why Pop Idol was so important to him and how he feels about Manchester.
I feel like all the pretensions have left, so I love being around people that are just so down to earth.
Plus, with the cast of Footloose, including Darren Day and Jake Quickenden, playing the definition quiz every night at 11:50.
Phil Shrow meets Will Young.
Tonight, from 10.
BBC Radio Manchester.
The Golden Hour.
The Golden Hour.
BBC Radio Manchester.
If he or she is good, is also valuable. I don't think it's corrupting in any way or distorting. I mean, obviously they're pushing their message, but it's the job of journalists to discern that and try and find the path through it to get to the truth. But generally, they're pretty valuable, I'd say.
But when a journalist or a director of communications comes to work for a newspaper, presumably the newspaper is buying something from them. That expertise, is it more than that? It's the access to power?
Maybe, but it's pretty transient as people move on. It's just if you hire them as a journalist, you're hiring them for their skills as a journalist, not necessarily for context that could disappear quite soon.
But if you're not hiring them as a journalist, that's something different, I suppose.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, I understand, everyone would understand that everyone needs sources at the heart of government, and that's what you're talking about. How much of a mouthpiece are you willing to be? You know, would you be happy for somebody, for one of your journalists, to be printing verbatim what someone like Dominic Cummings was telling them?
Well, Dominic Cummings tells everybody what he thinks about.
That's not
him
again. Thank you for calling Her Majesty's Highway. The operator is busy at the moment. Please hold until we are citizens.
in Petropolis and sent this report through Morodo of the Sea, the area most severely affected.
When the mudslide hit, it was hard to comprehend. Footage filmed on a resident's phone captures the shock, the disbelief. This is a country used to tropical rains, but the intensity of this downpour was unprecedented. And the destruction left in its wake is incomprehensible. This once crowded neighbourhood is now a muddied valley. And Petropolis is a city in trauma. We found one mother who'd come to recover her daughter's body, flanked by family with shovels in hand. Nearby, firefighters and families are picking apart the mangled steel and broken concrete, and quite literally piecing together what happened in the hope of finding loved ones.
Firefighters and residents are working together to find people buried in the mud. Firefighters just pulled out a piece of tiling, trying to work out where that tiling belonged to, which room, in order to identify where their loved ones could be.
Nielsen and his brother have been here for 2 days now, waiting for news of their sister, Lamileni. She was in the kitchen with my niece, he tells me. When she heard the roar coming down the mountain, she pushed her daughter out of the door and told her to run. She was saved, but my sister was left behind. He's not losing hope, though. It's the last thing to die, he says. While firefighters, police and troops have been drafted in, some residents say the help didn't come soon enough. So now, it's more a recovery than a rescue operation. Every so often, a stretcher is brought to collect a body, a refrigerated van.
No! What me? Come on, you fucking idiots. Get moving!
Along the road from the north and in the capital is still constant, despite the swirling rumours of war. That report by Fergal Keane. You're listening to the BBC World Service, and Neil has the headlines.
A judge in New York has ruled that the former President Trump must give evidence under oath to a state investigation into alleged fraud at his family business. The US Vice President Kamala Harris says world leaders meeting in Munich will demonstrate their unity in the face of Russian aggression on the Ukrainian frontier. Alarms warning of further heavy downpours have sounded in the Brazilian city of Petropolis just days after more than 100 people lost their lives in flash floods and mudslides.
Yes, nestled in the hills above Rio de Janeiro, Petropolis is a popular tourist destination, but its location leaves it prone to severe weather, and in recent days, that impact has been devastating. Landslides and flash flooding caused by a month's worth of rain falling in just 3 hours have left more than 100 people dead and more than 100 still missing. And with the alarms warning of further heavy rain in the coming hours, some residents are leaving the city. Our South American correspondent, Katie Watson.
Oh, no! 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 Oh, no!